Today I'm playing the 2021 video game Deathloop, a descendant of the Dishonored and Bioshock games with the sci-fi time loop as the core premise. I'll be narrating my play strategy, critiquing the game on a technical and artistic level, pointing out some Easter eggs that haven't been covered in other videos, discussing the ideas introduced in the game's story, and giving some of my general thoughts on video games and other topics. This is definitely an experimental video and will not be for everyone. I'm essentially doing a full-length film commentary only for a video game, and not even a very popular video game, just an interesting one. I'm playing on PC on a 1660 Ti with the modest settings you're seeing now. I'm using the Reshade post-processor to help get more of a cinematic look. You'll see some comparison images before the game starts. This is a pretty fast playthrough, but it's definitely not a regulation speedrun. I've spliced multiple playthroughs together to get the best takes, but I took the exact same route on all of them, so the splits are pretty seamless. And after these comparisons, we'll get into the game proper. And so here we are, the opening cinematic.
No, if you just give me a second.
In media res, we're put in the position of the protagonist not knowing what's going on, which is a classic storytelling technique. You know, our character has amnesia. He doesn't know what's going on, and we don't know what's going on either. And so we're in the same position as the protagonist character and not knowing what's going on. And so we have to learn what's happening just as he has to learn what's happening. And characters, Juliana in particular, are going to explain to him what's happening and thus explain to us what's happening. And so Colt thinks it was a dream, but it was definitely not a dream. It happened, and Juliana was very upset that he didn't remember what was happening. It's sort of an interesting story device, having these floating text missives. There's not really a coherent explanation, though, for why Colt can see these. You don't send any messages as your character. And yeah, there's really no in-story explanation for why you're seeing these. The guy playing Colt and the woman playing Juliana are very, very good. It's one of the aspects of this game that is definitely above average, even though I have a number of complaints with other aspects of the game. The voice acting is just top-notch here. Here I'm just grabbing one of the upgrade trinkets in the game. There's perks for your character and weapons, and special abilities that you collect in the form of these trinkets. And I actually don't need it for this introductory level here, but I collect it just for continuity reasons. This is very classic tutorial level type stuff that we're seeing here. We really don't return to this location. This is just the tutorial map.
Son of a, I don't know any damn code. Yo, hello? What
the? Maybe I should go look for this code.
Colt!
The interesting feature of most of the Eternalists is that they wear masks and body paint. I don't know why the Eternalists would have a particular desire to like hide their identity. They're living in sort of a world of no consequences in this time loop. And so protecting their identity isn't really all that necessary. I guess it could be more of a technical decision of, you know, we don't need that many character models, and it could be lots of different people. But then the design helps hide the fact of how few enemy models there are. But I somewhat doubt that that's the case. It could also be serving the mechanic where in this game you can have online players invade your game as Juliana. She has a number of special powers, but the main one you get when you're playing as her is the masquerade ability, which makes her look like one of the Eternalists. And then you can just pantomime that you're an NPC and then sneak up on Colt and kill him. So, you know, having the Eternalist be sort of like faceless and identical looking kind of helps serve that game mechanic. And so that might be the reasoning behind it.
It's Juliana, in case you didn't remember.
Okay, look, I don't know what I did last night exactly, but if you could just,
What? What did you say?
I think we know each other. We know each other, don't we?
Yes!
The jump that I made onto the overhanging light there, which I saw on speedruns, is a little bit tricky because of the invisible collision wall on the light is angled, and any invisible angled surface that you hop onto in this game, you start sliding down, so that you have to hit that light just right so that you don't slide down onto it, because as you're sliding, you can't jump, so you have to land on it and not move, and then jump through that hole into that larger opening area. And it's sort of an interesting, I think it's probably a metaphorical visual design. At first, you're locked in this sort of opening area, and then there's that locked door that I bypassed so that I could fiddle with the candy machine and the arcade machine. But I think that's sort of metaphorical for, it's like you're the protagonist character that you're inserted into is sort of entering this larger world. So he starts off sort of closed off and not knowing things, and then he opens up into this larger area by going through that first locked door, and then he goes to the library, this room of knowledge, so to speak. And so I think that's pretty intentional, but mechanically it's kind of uninteresting that you start in such a small room and you're stuck there for so long with nothing to do. So it's kind of artistically fulfilling, but not very fulfilling as a player of the game, which is why I jump past it.
Okay. You gotta be shitting me! Are you? Listen
to me?
You wrote it on Black Reef. You already know the code.
What the fuck does that mean?
Code. Hello? Are you dead yet?
What?
I'm waiting.
Pull me up!
Man, you have a postcard, dumbass! You wrote it on the Black Reef postcard! You understand? Okay. I'm gonna drop
wait,
you now.
Wait, no! Wait!
What the fuck?
No! No!
I just dropped myself. What kind of fucked up world is this? Okay, postcard. Get the postcard. Get off this beach.
That radio alarm is a clear reference to Groundhog Day. So what Frank says is something to the effect of, okay, so you just woke up and you don't know what's going on, right? So it's you know, a reference to the player's position. It's a little bit meta, you know, a little bit of a fourth wall break. You can interpret it that way of, you know, you're a cult. You just woke up on the beach. You don't know what's going on. And that's what Frank's saying. But, you know, since time is looping, you hear that radio every day that you wake up on the beach. You wake up and you pass that radio and it's the same thing, which is the position that Bill Murray's character was in the movie Groundhog Day. So the radio repeats, and you always know what's happening. And in the movie Groundhog Day, the dialogue on the radio show is that it's cold out there today. It's cold out there every day. And so that's apropos, because it is very cold and gets colder on this island of Black Reef. And you very frequently hear different characters complaining about how cold it is. The different Interless characters are constantly complaining about how cold it is outside and being bummed about it. And, you know, winter is sort of associated with, you know, seasonal depression. And in the 1993 Groundhog Day, there's a line from Bill Murray where he says, "I've got a weather prediction for you. It's going to be cold. It's going to be gray, and it's going to last you the rest of your life." And it's, you know, showing his character really getting fed up with the time loop. At first he's sort of stoked about it, and he thinks, you know, first he's confused, then he sort of starts to like it, and then he really starts to get depressed by it. And so I think the fact that it's so cold and that people keep complaining about it is sort of alluding to that. It's just this this depressive nature. It starts out okay. It seems like a good time, and then it's just not.
I don't even know where I'm going.
The Dorsey Square is down the road from the side. Let me guess. Second floor.
Sounds like you're angling for an invite.
So you can show off your little beer tap again?
Different me. This coat done talking to you.
By the way, everyone recognizes your stupid jacket.
I like this jacket. Hello? Anybody home?
Phoenix exclusive.
You want some kind of password, maybe? This is supposed to be my place. Kind of uptight. Wow.
So, wow, pretty. You know, pretty is subjective, but of course, anytime, you know, you have a male character look at some picture of a woman and say that she's pretty, you know, that she's a love interest, and it's foreshadowing that that's somebody that he knew in the past. Too easy. You know what's not easy though is that platforming. I kind of got hung up on the window, and that's definitely a complaint that I have with the game. And it seems like an intentional design choice to make the platforming a little janky. In many, many cases, you cannot just run up to a ledge and then hit the jump button and then climb up it. The edges of climbable objects often have kind of a cap ledge on top of them. So there's a small overhang. And so if you stand directly against an object and then try to climb it, you won't be able to. But if you step back just slightly, just a couple inches or so, then suddenly you can jump onto it. And this occurs in so many places in the game. It seems like it must be intentional, where you cannot just run up to something and then jump onto it. You really have to be careful about your timing, so the platforming is pretty finicky, which is kind of unsatisfying when trying to run the game quickly, and it's part of a theme of this game almost being anti-speedrun. You know, that there's a video of developers reacting to a speedrun of this game, and they mentioned that they have an internal speedrunning team. And yet this game seems like deliberately designed against you speedrunning it. One thing is because of the vault codes are randomized each playthrough, right? So the code that Colt has to find in the beginning to get into his tunnels is randomized every playthrough. The safe codes, they're all randomized. So you can't memorize them and then just execute them on each playthrough of the game. You have to learn them first. Now, luckily, most of the code dials have an autofill option, so you can just hold down a button to autofill them, so you don't actually have to press them in, but you do have to go find them in the world of the game before they can be used. Another thing is that there's not manual saving, right? So you can't just do a quick save and then rerun a section again. And so there's definitely some parts that are much trickier in the game that I would love to have been able to get to very quickly, you know, just like quick save, play a section, screw up, and then go back and then do it again and sort of practice a particular section over and over again. But it seems like, yeah, the game only auto-saves. It doesn't save at consistent points. There's this replay ability that Colt has that allows you to sort of, if you die, rewind in time, and the locations that you teleport back to are a little hard to predict. But yeah, the main save state seems to be controlled by the game's server. So your progress in the game is saved to an online server and being read from that. So you can't like hack it locally with files. So it's very hard to do anything but play the game straight through the way that it was intended. So yeah, it's pretty tricky to speedrun for that reason. Although I'm not very accustomed to speedrunning, and so there may be some tricks around that I'm not familiar with. And here's the dial. Here's this opening, which you get very accustomed to seeing. Hit Colt heading out of the tunnels and into some complex. And each area of the map has sort of like two different exit points with two different exit points. So. Depending on what time of day it is, you end up at sort of different entry points onto the part of Black Reef that you're particularly on. And that was another lovely exchange from our voice actors. very charismatic. Yeah. See, these Eternalus enemies are very much just cannon fodder, and this machete that you start with is totally OP, which is why I use it for the entire playthrough. I don't even bother with guns. I find the guns pretty ineffective in this game. You just run up and hit people, and that's incredibly effective. Took me a while to come up with the strategy for this particular section where I disable the turret to break these enemies out of their little dialogue loop so that they walk away and turn their backs. Because otherwise, if you just run up, they make too much noise, or if you just hack the turret and it shoots them, it makes too much noise, and it alerts the scout that I'm about to kill. Not this lady here, but I'm going to go up here, and there's a golden Eternalist scout, which they have these radios, and they'll call back up. You can hack their radios and disable them, and if you do that, then they become super dumb enemies. They're almost as bad as the drunk enemies because they waste time trying to activate their radio, and they just stand still for a minute and let you kill them. But yeah, some of these Eternalists are just straight up drunk. They're stumbling around like zombies, and so even if they're equipped with a gun, they're not going to use it on you. So yeah, the enemies in this game, incredibly, incredibly dumb, which some people have a problem with. You know, to me, most of the fun of the game is sort of the puzzle solving element. You know, it's figuring out how the different areas change at different times and trying to figure out how to get the information that you need to progress in the story. And the enemies are just kind of an obstacle. They might as well be zombies. It's like it doesn't really matter. They just make things a little bit more interesting. And then this sort of can lead me into some general commentary on AI in games generally. I don't know that I mean, even in cases where, you know, the enemy AI has really been promoted as being, you know, really sophisticated and a lot of work having gone into it, I've never been that impressed. I don't think I've seen one example where I was really impressed by how intelligent enemies were. It really just doesn't feel like that much work has gone into it, relatively speaking, compared to other aspects of making video games. And probably the reason is because you can just bring in human players if you want. If you want human complexity, right, you're not going to be able to compete really with human strategizing. And so, you know, what this game does is it has that invasion element where other people having copies of the game can play as Juliana and just invade and muck up your playthrough. And, you know, they're going to be potentially so much more sophisticated than any AI that could be written. That it really doesn't matter. And so that kind of seems like the trend that's happened is that, you know, video game developers have never put that much time into making really good enemy AI, the kind that could rival human players, because it's just easy to, you know, hook up a game to the internet and then just literally connect you to human players. And, you know, that's the more effective strategy. Colt's still trying to figure things out here. And this is all part of the game's tutorial section, right? So we're introducing the tunnel locking mechanics, the Juliana invasion mechanic. And that's really the only thing that's particularly randomized outside all the vault codes and things. You know, different information is available at different times of day, different, main characters, main NPCs are available in the same locations at different times of day. The enemies generally patrol in the same areas at the different times of the day. So most things are pretty predictable. Every time you go to a particular place at a particular time, you can pretty much expect the same thing to happen, with the exception of Juliana, where Juliana can invade, you know, maps at different times of day, just randomly, and you don't know. And in this particular case, yep, she shows up here somewhere around the antenna, but it's not always in the same place, so which is why I get on the roof to get the high ground so that I automatically win, like Ewan McGregor. Sometimes this goes better, sometimes this goes worse. That area that I just passed, the little corner below that ramp into my apartment, is a good place to put a proximity grenade. Because then if Juliana doesn't cooperate and makes a lot of noise and draws an Eternalist, they start trying to come up the stairs, and then they just cross a grenade there, and then they're dead. It's conveniently stair-shaped sculpture. It almost seems like it was put here on purpose to allow me to get into this window and see this. It's the Alexis's custom mix track. And you can look at that code and go to the sound booth and plug that in, and Alexis starts singing to it, which is one way to identify him. You can easily identify him by this pair of golden guns that he carries, but before you know that, you can either screw with his chocolate beer supply, or you can play his amazing jam to get him to stand out so that you can figure out who he is. And once again, everyone is wearing masks. It's part of the theme. And I don't know, I'm not sure artistically if anything's being said there. Masks are usually very symbolic, but I don't know, you know, exactly what it would mean in this case, where, you know, it's like the Eternalists are losing their humanity almost by participating in the loop. You know, they all become, they may have been unique individuals, but now they're all just, you know, puppets in this world that's really run by Juliana. Juliana is essentially just God here, which is, you know, makes her kind of an annoying character to me. I mean, I understand the character as written. She seems to have gone through like a lot of trauma, and so it's not like her behavior is surprising, but you know, it's definitely, it definitely seems to be sort of the position she's in. She really likes the time loop because she's the only one that remembers everything, which gives her this huge, huge advantage over every other person in Black Reef, where she's essentially Bill Murray from Groundhog Day, and she just comes off looking like a god. She just knows everything and can do anything. She's collected all the slab powers for herself. So she really is just God, and she does whatever she wants.
Expect the same outcome.
Yep, but she's very happy that he's ready to kill her. Because apparently that's the only joy that she gets is from dying over and over and over again. But only when it doesn't matter. Only when it all resets the next day, and it was like it never happened. It's very strange, very strange. So we're well into the time loop mechanics now. A newish dawn. And I already mentioned Groundhog Day is probably my main point of reference, but obviously there's a lot of other shows and games that have used the same time loop concept. Something that people might not be familiar with, it seems particularly apropos, is a 2006 TV series called Daybreak, which starred Taye Diggs, which someone you should know from the movies Rent and Equilibrium. But he was playing a detective who was framed for murder and was caught in a time loop. And each episode, he was reliving the same day and like doing different things to try to figure out what was going on. One of the antagonist characters was played by Jonathan Banks, who you might know as Mike from Breaking Bad. But I definitely thought of this a couple times during that thing where it's really the sole character puzzling through and trying to unravel the mystery and encountering these different obstacles and then repeatedly being antagonized and dying. Unfortunately, that TV show was canceled and it brings up bad memories. That was one of the last nails in the coffin. That might have been actually the last show that I ever started watching from the beginning. And it was just so disappointing to see that show canceled because it was such a great concept for a TV show. Like a time loop is a perfect concept for a TV series because you get to reuse the same sets and actors every day. But then all these different things can happen and it's got this cool time travel element. It's a really, really great concept. And that show was really, really good. And it's really highly rated on IMDb. But it was canceled for, you know, mysterious reasons. And it never even completed its first season. And so there was no satisfying conclusion to that story. And then, you know, I was like, I'm never going to be hurt like that again. I'm not watching any more TV series until they're ended. So, like, I watched Breaking Bad when it was over, right? It's like after it ended and I knew it had a satisfying conclusion, you know. The same with, like, Game of Thrones. I didn't watch Game of Thrones. I waited for it to end. And the people were like, well, it was good for a while, but then the ending sucked. And I was like, okay, I'm just not going to watch it. I'm just not going to be disappointed. Taking the same route. This game does get a little bit repetitive, which because of the premise, I kind of don't mind. And it's kind of a meta element of the game where, you know, that's really the superpower you have in every game. You know, no matter how apparently skillful you get in a game, you know, you can see very impressive runs of many different games in YouTube videos. But, you know, the secret behind every single one of them is you have unlimited retries. You know, if you screw up, you can just go back and do it again. There's no permanent consequence to making a mistake in the video game. So this game is sort of making that mechanic explicit and saying, yes, you can make unlimited mistakes and you die and you restart over. And so it's just the non-diegetic reality of your infinite retries as the video gamer are expressed diegetically through a cult interpretation of events as well, where, you know, you can just die as many times as you want and it's all okay. This is an annoying menu tutorial. It's a little verbose. There should really be an option to disable this, but there is not for mysterious reasons. I also had that menu glitch out more than once, where pop-up overlays just didn't come up, or they came up and then got frozen on screen. One of the game's little bugs. Another bug is getting stuck on doors. Often when you go through a door like that, you kind of get hung up. You get hung up on some invisible wall and have to like back up and turn.
This infusion keeps sounding better and better.
Nice little snowy area in the complex here. And this is sort of reminding me of James Bond a little bit. It's a very interesting production design for this game. It's definitely, like, it's probably second after the voice acting. It's probably my second favorite thing about the game. It's just this very interesting style of, you've got, like, these, like, old war bunker type places nestled in the snow. But then, you know, and then also, like, this old fishing colony and these almost like castle-like regions. And here I'm going to get hung up on that stupid ledge. So that's exactly what I was talking about. It's like you can't just go up to it and jump onto it. You got to back up and then jump onto it because of that little ledge there. Again, it has to be on purpose. And it's super annoying because like there's many areas where you can almost like parkour like you were playing Mirror's Edge or something. And those damn little ledges screw you up. You got to be really precise. But yeah, so you've got these almost medieval rundown exteriors, Cold War exteriors. But then inside, it's like this total 60s, you know, vibe. Very, very retro and suave. And that's a very interesting contrast. So I really like that just the visual design of the environments. It's really neat. Big fan of that. But one of the things that the bunkers in the snow really reminds me of is James Bond Goldeneye. You know, it was like these Soviet bunkers that, you know, James Bond was hunting around. And it's sort of one of the allusions to spy movies made in the game. I mean, obviously you have a little, you know, hacking device, and some people have described the dynamic between Colt and Juliana as sort of being a spy versus spy kind of thing. But I don't know. It's like, to me, a lot of this doesn't feel like spy work. You know, it's not like yet you're hacking into any of the actual terminals in most cases. That seems more like a spy thing. Like I have to, you know, get a password into a computer and then hack information from that. Or I've got to, you know, liquor somebody up so they divulge some secrets or something. So that's kind of a weird, you know, it's one of these things that doesn't quite gel for me, where it kind of feels like there was some drafts where Colt was more of a straight up spy character, like a James Bond character, and then that got pulled back on it at some point during development, because the outro music that happens with the credits is very, very James Bond. You know, you got some female artist singing a song that includes the title Deathloop, and it sounds, yeah, sounds exactly like a James Bond intro. But like I said, and you've got those markers there of a James Bond environment, but the gameplay doesn't really back that up. Here's another stupid platforming thing. I deployed that turret, and the results are kind of they're not consistent. I've had times where I've deployed that turret and then I come back and everyone's dead, which is very convenient. Often just two people are dead and then there's just one to finish off, which is pretty convenient. In this case, you know, they destroyed the turret before anybody got killed by it, so I had to do a lot of work. And I know that the Wenjis jump through those little holes in the wall that I'm just walking past now. And so I thought, hey, maybe I can jump through those because you can jump through windows generally. But nope. Nope, you can't. That's disappointing. All right. Now. And there's a lot of situations like that where it's just this ambiguity of, is the game treating this like a wall? Is it treating it like a window? Is it treating it like a climbable object? And there's some ambiguities there. And here I am, deliberately fiddling with guns to let Colt finish his line. Again, that's part of what makes this not really a true speedrun, because I do a number of things that just are the interest of continuity and story and the smoothness of collecting information. But Colt just infused himself, so he's got the ability to use residuum now. So effectively, you can buy perks, you can buy weapons and perks, but then they disappear at each loop unless you. So you have to acquire them and then buy them with residuum, so that they're permanent and not temporary acquisitions. Here's a little thing there where I just stopped at the top of that ledge. It's another weird ledge climbing thing, and that's because the first time you climb up that ledge, there's floating letters that say something about your name, like what's your name or something like that. And so to make sure that you notice that, the player notices that, they put a little pause in there as you climb to the top of that first ledge. You climb up and then you pause to give you extra time to see the floating words, and then you can move, but you're temporarily stuck there. But every other time you walk up there, when the words are not there, you still get stuck there, and so it's very annoying. And so sometimes I like whip the camera to the right and back to try to get off of it, but it's amazing the little details that you notice when you play over the same level 200 times.
This gun after me.
It is cute that he's trying to name the gun after him. And it's interesting that his name is Colt, which is, you know, like a Colt 45. It's an actual gun, and he is a destructive force. Like a gun, he's here to kill. He's here to kill time, as you sometimes see in the summary page after you get off a level. If you didn't kill any of the visionaries, it says just killing time, and so that's a common phrase. Obviously, I'm just killing time. I'm wasting time. You know, I've got time to spare, and I need to kill it. But he's literally trying to break this time loop, and so it's a little bit of a wordplay there. He's killing time, you know. Sam switching to a single player mode so that it's only NPC Julianas that invade my game and not actually other players. I'm not going to do that for a recording here. Nice little time change. As I said before, other movies have used the Groundhog Day concept, the time loop concept, such as Live, Die, Repeat, Edge of Tomorrow is the alternate title, that Tom Cruise movie. But then, you know, the mechanics have been seen in other games. The Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask is a time loop game, but even in like Ocarina of Time, you know, you had that element of you change the time of day to make other things available and solve puzzles.
I infuse myself a gun, might infuse some trinkets, I might infuse a slam.
What's your point?
That I figured out how to infuse things.
You think this is the first time? When did you crack that Sunday 7?
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure what determines the order of these different dialogue lines. Certainly, when you go to certain places after certain events, there's always the same little exchanges that happen between Colt and Julianna. But sometimes it seems a little bit randomized. I'm not exactly sure what determines what gets played when. Anyway, right now I'm just literally just going over here to notice that Otto's firework shop is burned down by noon. For this recording, I disabled alerts, but the game, you know, by default will alert you whenever you've learned something new, and it automatically records that for you. Almost all the information is just automatically recorded and then brought up for you, so you don't really have to take notes in the game, even though there is a lot of information to track. But obviously it's an option, you know, that you can disable it, and so you can mostly hide it and ignore it if you would prefer to take your own notes for a different type of experience. Taking the long route in this time. This is the phase of the game where I'm just repeatedly going to Charlie's game here and getting the shift ability, which is a teleport, and then upgrades to that teleport. And as a lot of people commented, the game seems more designed for using teleport. You know, obviously it helps mitigate that platforming issue, and so that again might have something to do with that decision of putting little caps on things where a wider top platform gives you a clear teleport point. And then because you can't just run up to things and climb up on them reliably, you have to have precise timing. That makes the teleport seem a lot more efficient in most cases, even though the base teleport It might be like the same height as a double jump, or maybe even a little less than a double jump. So with a double jump and the shift ability, you can get pretty far. But if you want to use like weapons with other character perks, you might not have the double jump equipped anymore. And so then you just have the shift. So just an interesting design choice of the having the double jump and the shift, and then you can use both or one or the other. But the shift definitely makes platforming a lot easier. So it's not strictly needed for the game, and this playthrough would be a lot shorter if I just completely ignored shift, or if I just got the base upgrade and then didn't get the reach. That's what I'm really going for, is the reach upgrade. But the upgrades, interestingly, are also randomized. So you get upgrades in different orders. There's one that lets you switch places with somebody, one that lets you hover in the air to give you a little more time. You know, if you like double jump and then shift, you can precisely aim. There's a little force kick that you can do. You kick while teleporting, and so it's an attack teleport combination. And then there's reach, which just extends how far you can teleport, and that's the one that I want. And so I think for the recorded playthroughs, I have to come back twice more to get the actual upgrades to eventually get the reach. But this is probably the most difficult part of the game. So it's like this key mechanic is the shift mechanic, and it's locked behind this pretty challenging paintball setup here. That's what this reminds me of. It's like a little it's like a building setup for paintball or airsoft or like laser tag, something like that. And it's also a little bit Disney-ish, like a little bit theme park, amusement park, which is definitely a design theme that you see where, you know, that's kind of part of the reason that people are dressed up and things are painted up, and it's made to be like this theme park, this leisure park of just endless fun with no consequences. It's like Las Vegas, you know. What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, sort of thing. You see, the game is pretty forgiving though, with even with this being the most challenging part, the fact that you can die and then teleport back is very convenient, and then the game is pretty generous with health bottles, health pickups, you know, all over the place, like right there, so that you can recharge. And so I very easily just tank a lot of damage during this playthrough. It's not that hard to get by. But yeah, depending on what power set you have, you can approach this section in a couple different ways. Again, this is the trickiest section. Here I'm just going to pick up that detail. Know that Fia and Charlie have a little lover's tryst thing going on. You need that for story progression. And then I'm also just wandering around and picking up some extra residuum from objects, because you get 10,000 from killing Charlie, but to keep the shift power itself, you need 15,000. And so I'm making sure that I have 15,000 when I go in. You can sacrifice some items from your inventory to get a little bit more without having to collect some. But I'm just collecting some to make sure I have 15,000 so I can keep the ability before I get back. And then obviously with shift, movement becomes a lot faster and a lot more fun. So pretty important for enjoying the game to get it, which is sort of that brings up an interesting point to me about video games in general, which is that, you know, the weird thing about, you know, I tend to like video games more like this. You know, I don't play video games that much, But when I do, it's more like highly produced, story-driven games with like puzzly elements and maybe some 3D platforming. But I really like more of a story as opposed to a mechanic based game that requires a lot of precision or fast twitch reflexes, which I don't have. Like my reflexes are definitely slower than average, so I'm not very good at quick responses. You know, I fail quick time events half the time. They're not even particularly hard, but and that's also something that it seems like you can't improve based on research that I found and training that I've actually done to try to improve my reflexes and my response time. I've just found that it seems like it cannot be done. It's just sort of genetically determined how quickly you can respond to different stimuli. And so being something that's really fast paced or a competitive first person shooter or fighting games, I'm just rubbish at. So they're kind of off the table for that reason alone. But you know, the thing with video games is that, you know, there's this promise of just like endless possibility. Like, you know, you can go through and you could take this strategy or that strategy, you could take the left path or the right path, et cetera, et cetera. But almost inevitably, there's always one path that's more satisfying. And there's lots of games, you know, even games that have a lot of real choices as opposed to like the fake ones presented by, like the Telltale games famously sort of pretend that your choices matter a lot more than they do, but they're kind of collapsed to, a singularity at the end. But to me, that really is, you know, every game sort of an illusion of that to some degree, where, you know, what you really want is a good story, and you can be telling the story through your actions, or it could be, you know, more linearly driven through cutscenes or whatever. But there's always an experience that's going to be better. And what makes a game good is not really that it gives you all of these options. It's that it gives you a bunch of options, and then the direction of the game, the design and the art direction, leads you into, and perhaps the writing as well, leads you into making the choice that is the most narratively satisfying. That's sort of my theory about like what makes a game good. It's not about having all the choices, because, you know, like I said, very reliably, you give people lots of choices. If people, and you know this, I know live streamers are accustomed to this, you play games with choices, and then people will constantly, you know, rail on you for making the wrong choices and playing the game wrong, you know, because they correctly observe that if you take a certain approach, you go certain ways, you make certain narrative choices, the game is less satisfying, you know. And it's not like some people would prefer this way. No, I mean, in general, most people prefer a single path. And so video games with choices, the point of the choices is really to provide an illusion of choice. It's not actually to give players the choice. Giving players the choice gives them the choice to choose, gives them the option of choosing wrong, essentially. So what you want is a movie that feels interactive. And sort of a speed run is a nice example of that, and sort of an embodiment of that philosophy of you're literally acting out a pre-planned route. And so here, like I'm doing that, you know, I know for, you know, this recording, I know exactly what route I was going to take, and why, and had done it multiple times before even pressing record for the first time. But then it's more like, you know, the experience of playing the game is like being an actor in a play or something, right? It's like I'm trying to hit, you know, the right beats and the right marks, right? I'm trying to say the right lines of dialogue at the right time. I'm putting on a performance. You know, it's also a little bit like playing music. You know, I'm just trying to hit the right notes at the right time to make music. And if you go off beat, or if you start playing different notes, then it's just not satisfying. You know, it's like, but yes, it's like playing an instrument. is more satisfying than just, you know, listening to a recording. Like, live music does have a charm to it because, again, it's almost that possibility that you could play a different note. You know, if I'm sitting there strumming a guitar, it's like I could play a different chord at any time. I could just randomly strum louder at any time, right? I could change the tempo at any time, but I don't, right? Because if I did, then it would ruin the music. You know, it would ruin the aesthetics. Made a comment on a little some game stuff here, where I'm taking the strategy this time of activating the rocket using this 2-bit AI that Charlie made, and it's gonna basically burn up and auto kill the people on the top level there, or at least a lot of them. But you have to sort of sneak around and get these extra batteries. But what's weird, at least in my, you know, like I said, I think I saw different information in different guides. So I don't know when this decision was made, but there's an extra slot for a battery that's empty that you can't interact with. So I think I'm going to get one more battery and then slot it in there. And it's hard to do this stealthily because, as you can hear, 2-bit is basically, has got sensors in the whole place and knows what you're doing and starts telling the other players as you're killing them. So it's, you know, it's if you had Igor's ether ability, maybe you could, you know, turn invisible and sneak around here. But yeah, there's that slot there, but there's another one on that same wall that you just can't interact with and you don't need. And so it seems like originally that this rocket sequence was going to be a little more challenging. You needed one extra battery, and then that was dropped at some point to make this a little bit more doable. So it's just a weird thing.
Delta V reactor burn is go! 3, 2, 1!
And I don't usually do this. I kind of do it for fun here, but it's not exactly clear when the rocket is done burning. But you can see when we go up here that it does indeed burn. But there's some survivors up here.
Paint identification! You can't win!
Alright, so I got her out of the way. I'm gonna switch to the backup strategy here. Just before, I just ran up and hit Charlie, but Charlie retreats. He retreats to his little bunker, but if you run through his bunker and get past his security, he'll run out through that room there. And so you can just plant a few proximity mines there, and so then if he does get out, he just blows up instantly. So at this point, he's already dead no matter what, right? I'm either going to kill him right now, which is actually what happens if you hack this turret through this window. He's just standing right across. He's standing directly in front of that turret in the corner of the room, and so it just shoots him. But sometimes he does actually run out and survive that shooting. But if he does, yeah, he'll just exit through that room and blow up. So usually I try to run straight to the entrance of the bunker area from the game, and he'll try to retreat to his bunker, and so, like in that first playthrough, he just runs right into me and I just kill him. Or you try to kill him here with the turret, or he runs into that backup turret. So here's another weird glitchy game thing. Because I kill him here, this is the downside of killing him here. Sometimes his little slab pickup will glitch through the wall to the other side and you have to go outside to get it, which is what I thought happened at first. But I turned on the tracker so that I could see indeed it just happened to spawn right behind that little stand up decoration. And so I had to get in just the right position and lean to be able to pick it up. Certainly did not go through all that effort to not to not leave with an upgrade. It's a little jank. It's a pretty game. Interesting ideas. A little jank at times though. And obviously I'm playing this game and I'm playing and recording at 30 frames. You know, I'm using a 1660 Ti, so I couldn't run this, you know, at 60 frames per second and record it, you know, regardless of what game it was. But this particular game, notoriously has performance issues. You will never see a recording of this game without dropped frames in it. It just does not run that well, and I don't exactly know why that is. Because there's plenty of games that look better than this that also run better than this. So it might be their engine or their particular design. You know, I'm not going to be too hard on them because I was a developer myself before, and in fact my specialty was in computer graphics. So I do, while I haven't done video game development myself, maybe I will in the future, but I do have a technical understanding of how much work goes into developing a game like this. And so, yeah, I'm not going to like rake anybody through the mud for the little things here, because I know just the insane amount of work that goes into getting all the little details right. But I do have to notice that, yeah, a lot of other games do not have these problems. And so it's kind of disappointing.
So, what's your opinion on secrets?
She's just playing with him. She just messes with him. She gaslights him. It's a very interesting psychology that she has. Where she's... On the one hand, you know, there's some dialogue at some point that she says where, you know, she knows that he doesn't know what's going on and doesn't remember what happened in the past. And so effectively, he's like a different person. So this is kind of gets into philosophy a little bit of, and this is something I said in my video on, on identity, you know, are you a clone? Because this character has amnesia to a degree, and so it's like he really is a different person, and you can't really recognize him as the person that she's talking about in the past sense. But then she's still angry at him, and she still wants to hold him accountable for things that he did in the past that he doesn't remember. It's a little bit of a Bucky Winter Soldier situation. Did bad things in the past that he doesn't remember. Do we still hold him accountable for those things? Even though now he's effectively a different person. So again, you see right there, I just stood by the entrance. I was standing in that corner to see if Charlie would run into me. In that case, he didn't. And you can sort of scare him away from that corner by lingering there too long. And so then he starts just like teleporting around the upper two levels to random locations. So now I just have to go up and find him. He's not in the bunker, but you can kind of memorize the places he stands. In this case, I get kind of lucky after I clear out these people. He literally just, you know, he just teleports to the upper level, like right in front of me, and I just run up to him and kill him. You know, it's not very difficult. Probably the most difficult thing is just the variety of things that can happen and the different strategies you have to take depending on what power set that you have. His little marker indicating his position. Yeah. He's like, I thought I saw somebody. It's like, yeah, sure you did. Can't remember if we've gotten to the line yet where it's kind of a funny thing. Again, it's a good voice acting, good directing thing that I like. Of just this line of, wait a minute, we killed you when you come back with your reprise ability. Where it's this tone of, oh, that's not fair, that's cheating, you know. You're not allowed to come back to life. Which is kind of weird to me. It's an interesting, like, writing psychology choice, because it's like the enemies, like, lore-wise, they're a combination of, like, ex-cons, but, you know, most of them are, like, just, like, rich kids that bought their way in and are looking for, you know, like, an endless party or something. But, you know, like, these people coming up to Charlie's game It's like the, you know, they all have just loaded weapons, and so it's like they're all ready to die at any time. But from their perspective, you know, it's the first day of the loop. It's not actually the first day of the loop. The loop's been going on for decades, but from their perspective, it's the first time. So yesterday, in their mind, in their psychology, they were just ordinary people. But then today, like, they're ready to die like it's nothing, right? Like they're, yep, we're just gonna shoot each other. And, you know, like, from a psychology standpoint, that I just find that a little bit implausible of being that willing to trust in the concept of the loop despite having no evidence, essentially. You know, you've got assurances from scientists, you've got some weird temporal artifacts and things floating around, but yeah, I don't know. It's a little questionable that people would be that trusting to overcome their survival instincts and be like, yeah, I'm just gonna jump off a cliff. I'm just gonna put a gun in my mouth and pull the trigger, right? And nothing bad's gonna happen. Which gets to a sort of another interesting game decision. It would be very convenient. Like sometimes, I don't know. There's like two or three times in this run where instead of running back to the exit, I just kill myself, right? Using grenades or something else, because then you just loop to the next day. So if there's, you know, if it's like noon and there's nothing to do in the afternoon or evening in any area, and you just want to do something in the morning, then instead of running to the exit and then going back to the loading screen and then advancing the time around to the next day, you can just die a couple times. You know, speedrunners will grab a nullifier from the map if it has one to disable Colt's reprise ability, and then you just have to kill yourself once. But even killing yourself three times is faster than running to the exit. But what would be really convenient is if you could just, like, you could literally just make that choice as like a mechanic, if you could literally just like shoot yourself in the head, because you actually see one of the visitor Colts do that, at least one, shoot himself to escape your uncomfortable presence, I guess. And so one wonders then, why can't I just do that as the player? Why do I have to go through some elaborate charade or something? And I wonder if that was just an oversight, or if it was like an optics thing of like, well, you know, you don't want to have a game where there's a mechanic of literally shooting yourself in the head over and over again. We're going to get angry letters from parents if we do that. Anyway, there, I got really lucky again. Again, I just stood in that corner and the Australia ran right into my arms just the way I wanted. I tried to get a breather by peeking into his the little entry room leading to his bunker there, because none of the enemies will follow you into it. But didn't quite work, but it's so easy to get in here. Dying really does not cost much. And, you know, in most games, I try not to die so much. It's a little bit psychologically disconcerting, but I feel like I was actually more willing to kill the player character to achieve objectives faster in this game, just because of that lore idea, like the story premise being that, well, it's like Colt's already died thousands of times. It's like, you know, what's one more time, you know? Right, just like Bill Murray in Groundhog Day has probably, you know, gotten depressed and committed suicide 100 different ways on 100 different days. So why do I care about protecting him? You know, why do I care about, you know, hey, if the fastest way to get to tomorrow is to jump off the cliff, then I'm jumping off the cliff, you know. I'm not jumping off the cliff. You know, the most fun thing to do in this game is the teleport door open. It's like literally teleporting to a door and then hitting the interact button right after to just seamlessly plow through the door. Doesn't always work, though. I don't know if my timing's just not perfect. Sometimes it seems like I drop a frame right as it's happening, and that's what's screwing it up. Here we have a little Juliana intervention I have to deal with. I'm taking familiar routes here. Sometimes you end up in a weird place, and the efficient route is a little convoluted or unplanned, but I already had a route to get back to the exit, and then I have a route from the exit to Colt's Flat, which is where the antenna is on this map, so it was very easy to get there that way, but you can pretty much always use that strategy. These maps are definitely confusing, and I want to say that I like that, but it is an interesting choice, another design choice, to not have good maps. There's no mini-map, you know, it's not just disabled for this playthrough, there just is no mini-map in this game. And you have printed maps that you can collect, but they're almost impossible to read. Like, even when you go to one, it doesn't tell you what your location is, and it's not photorealistic. It's not like a satellite image, it's a, you know, a stylistic rendering. There's no compass, so there's no saying what's north and what's south. Nothing is labeled as being a particular building, and so the maps are highly indecipherable. And then the levels themselves are not like neatly organized into streets. There's not label street names. There's not a grid that's easy to follow. There's like all things at different heights, like crumbling walls, and there's always multiple ways to get to any particular thing. And so it feels like, you know, you've just been plopped into like an old city, like, you know, in the United States, like you're in Baltimore, New York, or, you know, maybe parts of Los Angeles or something, where it's just, you're just in this super unfamiliar city, and you can't see any of the street signs, and you don't have GPS, and you just got to figure out. And so that's one of the things that you learn through going through these maps over and over again on different days. You have to do it the old-fashioned way and recognize landmarks, you know, and then you sort of like figure out, it's like, okay, well, I know how to get from, you know, landmark A to landmark B, and then I also know how to get from, you know, landmark B to landmark C, and then from landmark C to landmark D, you know, and so then you start chaining things together. It's like, okay, well, I'm at landmark B and I need to get to D, and so I know I don't know how to get from D to D from B, but I can get from B to C and then C to D, and so, you know, you kind of use these heuristics to get around, which is kind of interesting, and it's realistic and it's kind of fun. But then I also wonder if it's just because people complained about the game maps being, you know, I mean, there's only four of them besides the intro level, which, again, you're only at for a very brief time. But they're not very big, so they're sort of labyrinthine, you know, they're maze-like and hard to get around, especially when you're going at different times of day. And so things look slightly different at different types of day, and so that sort of defies your comprehension a little bit of recognizing landmarks, because they change in appearance slightly over time. But one wonders if it was just sort of like an efficiency thing on the part of the developers, where it's like, well, the maps aren't that big, I don't know, it's like we're having problems with our game engine performing, we don't want to make the maps bigger, but we want them to feel bigger, and so we're just going to make them sort of, you know, sort of like the Inception, strategy of, we're just going to make some Penrose steps in here, and so because it's confusing, it's going to feel like the level is a lot bigger than it actually is. So yeah, you wonder if is it a artistic choice, or is it a pragmatic choice, or is it both? I don't know. In my experience, usually the answer is both in cases like this. It was voted on by different members of the team who had different rationales for producing the same conclusion. Got my shift upgraded and got my one trinket that I care about, which is speedy hacking. Yeah, honestly, as much as I played this game, yeah, I just don't care much for the weapons and don't care much for the upgrades either. I just didn't really find any of them particularly interesting. Which is honestly kind of true in, again, my most similar comparison points, like Dishonored and the Bioshock games. You know, what this has, you know, I think there actually is some overlap in the people. Some of the people who worked on some of the Bioshock games also worked on this game at some point in time. But it definitely has the Bioshock premise of you're a character with no memory in some sort of sci-fi fantasy world, right? You know, in the first Bioshock, you're some guy who doesn't have memory because his mind's been, you know, messed with to turn him into a plant, to turn him into sort of a Manchurian candidate type thing. And he's plopped into this underground Ayn Rand society, or this underwater Ayn Rand society. You know, in Bioshock Infinite, you're up in the clouds. And it's like this religious, super moral, you know, return to 1900s morality, experimental, thing. And you don't have a memory there because of time travel shenanigans. And, the same thing's happening here where it's like, well, you don't have a memory because of time travel shenanigans. And again, is this sort of utopian vision of the society where, yeah, the loop is just eternal. It's an interesting turn of phrase, break the loop. That reminds me of the movie Looper, which is not exactly a time loop movie, but it is a time travel movie. And of course, they're always talking about closing the loop with the loopers. You know, they eventually hired assassins who kill people from the future in the past to avoid legal repercussions. But eventually, they retire by being sent the future version of themselves to kill. And that's closing the loop, you know? It's closing the loop, breaking the loop. The loop presumably being a reference to, I mean, time generally, certainly, and the looped time, but it's also the physical loop of the infinity symbol, which you can, it's sort of, that's the motive for the symbol on the screen right now for the reprisability, the little infinity loop symbol. That's a little sloppy here in this execution. You can definitely kill her silently and then not draw attention until you jump out here. And I just literally jump out and get up on top of this thing, because once you do, there's a vent here, but then you can also just hop right over here, and this is a pretty fast way into getting to Frank here. And I'm gonna activate one turret that's already downstairs. There's a second one up here you could also throw over if you want a little extra help. But there's a health station conveniently located up here with, looks like Frank's little loft area.
You were supposed to prank him!
So things are pretty simple. And we're about to pick up a cassette tape, with Frank's, giving up some secrets. And something that took me a while to notice, actually, is that if you look at the little tape players, yeah, this is Frank's kind of has a movement slowing ability. He's pretty tough. He might be one of the tougher visionaries, honestly. Some of the ones I had more trouble with, because I don't know if there's any way into his room there besides just opening it up. I mean, there might be a more clever thing you can do. Maybe just wait a long time and he comes out eventually. But anyway, you know, it's not exactly clear who Colt is. He doesn't really know who he is, but he seems to be some kind of like military engineer. and because he definitely does a lot of tinkering. But that tape player you see is really the basis for his hack-a-ma-jig, which took me an embarrassingly long time to realize. But if you see Colt using his hack-a-ma-jig, it's one of those tape players that you see lying around that he has modified, which is an interesting little design element. You know, it could have been, you know, you could have been made anything into the hacking device, but to have it based on an object that is readily available in the world makes sense character-wise. It's probably a little efficient in terms of modeling and game production as well, but just a nice little detail.
Colt fixed him up right for me.
Yeah, Colt the tinkerer. But he was apparently part of some military outfit, Operation Horizon, and it's not clear, you know, like, I'm playing the game in English here, and, you know, you would naively assume it was like a U.S. government operation, but then there's this Rakieto plane in the Ark complex, and again, the bunker style reminds me of GoldenEye, so that there's like this sort of Russian theme. It's like Soviet era bunkers and technology, but then, you know, and then there's this reference to like in some of the military signage, it's like this bear figure and then this like army of the motherland, and so like the motherland is more like Russia or maybe Germany, but then the bear kind of looks like Smokey the Bear, which is definitely American, and so it's sort of this weird, you know, I mean, it kind of plays into the, again, the production design overall, which is this weird mix of influences, and so it's kind of, it's a little timeless, which is probably intentional, right, because you're in this time loop and you're playing with time, and so you kind of feel out of time. This could be any time. Good thing that grenade has a cancel button, because I almost blew myself up hitting the wrong key instead of the hack-a-ma-jig. It'd be much easier to make this jump now that I have teleport. Love that animation. That's my favorite machete animation. That bending over backwards and decapitating him. That's fun. Juliana comes to wreck things here too. Throw a monkey in the wrench. I think that's a corruption of the phrase. It's what movie is that? This Bruce Willis says that in some. Oh yeah, in Die Hard. Monkey in the wrench.
Two-bit can edit and broadcast audio. That weird little cyborg's been holding out.
Yeah, this is tricky. I screwed this up on a number of playthroughs of the game because you have to read these emails and you have to read this note here on the board, and you also have to play this tape here. You need all three of those to have enough information to invite Dr. Wingy Evans to the to Alexis's party, and so definitely on some runs I forgot one piece of information there. You need all of it. It's very important. Wingy's got a weird way of speaking. She's probably the character that I like least in terms of her dialogue writing. You know, it's a little Big Bang Theory for me, where it's a little, you know, little pseudo scientific. You know, it's like guessing produces an unacceptable margin of error, and it's just like, you know, applying scientific jargon to like just like common phrase. It's like nobody talks like that. It's just very silly. It's very, very stereotypical scientist. I'm Dr. Scientist, you know. What I do like in terms of the dialogue is the just like the conversations that Eternalists have amongst themselves. You know, you do hear some random lines repeated a number of times, and that can get a little bit old. But there's a surprising amount of leads and lore information just in casual conversations that you overhear, which is nice. Something else that I haven't commented on is Colt's height. You know, the player height is implied by the position of the camera, and you know, it actually feels like Colt is pretty short. He's the camera position makes it look like he's a lot shorter than his character model would suggest, and I'm guessing that was a choice made to make platforming easier. But yeah, if you look at like Colt's crouch state versus his uncrouched state, there's not much difference there. He doesn't have a lot of height to see things. And so I think that it puts you a little bit closer to buttons and dials, so they can be modeled at like a reasonable like hand height, but then your head's sort of like looking at them already. And then for like low ledges and things, you know, maybe it's a little bit easier to see them, so it might help a little bit in interactions and platforming without you needing to you know, change the heights of like props and interactable objects to look wrong, so that the world looks correct and the interactions are easier, but the sort of consequence or the trade-off is that Colt ends up seeming a little shorter than they should. Really, I should have just gone back the way I came here. I don't have a good route out this way. This is kind of a maze of traps, but for whatever reason, I just thought it would be more fun to exit this other route for this run. And the shadows are looking okay on this map too. This is another bug that I got with this game is, even when running on the lowest settings, you know, of the game, about half the time I would load up this complex map and the shadows would just be, they would just be broken. You know, like tons of stuff would just be, you know, totally dark as if it was unlit. And just, you know, reloading it would fix it. It was just a random visual glitch. Yeah, it's unfortunate. A number of janky things.
Seems Igor skips the part.
But I really like this puzzle solving element, going to different places at different times. So Colt's waking up here again, and I'm going to draw attention to the fact that Colt is wearing gloves. He's wearing a leather jacket and leather gloves. Juliana also wears gloves, and this is not unique to this game. You see that a lot. I mean, it is practical clothing for wielding certain types of weapons, but I'm theorizing. I don't know for sure. Again, I don't have a background in game development and game design, but I'm thinking that this is for player insertion purposes, because in this game you can play as Colt and Juliana, you know, ostensibly, but you're playing in the first person, right? So you're adopting the stance of the character, and so even though, you know, like Colt has a complete character backstory, right? He's got these, you know, existing relationships and these other things that he's done and this whole life that he's had. But at the start of the game, he has amnesia and he doesn't know who he is. And so he really could be anybody. And so it could be you. So you're taking the first person's perspective and you're starting like him, not knowing what's going on. And so you're clearly meant to insert yourself into the character's perspective, so that yeah, you're kind of playing as Colt, but you're also playing as yourself, right? And I'm wondering if the gloves are a design element that's intentionally there to avoid a discongruity, because, you know, Colt of course is a black male character, but looking at his hands, which is the only part of him you see most of the time, you wouldn't necessarily know that, would you? Because he's wearing gloves, and the same with Juliana. It's like you don't have, you know, that discord there of, you know, if you're white or Asian, you look down, you see these, you know, clearly African American paws, you know, clutching these weapons. Maybe that takes you out of the game a little bit. And so I'm wondering if it really is just to avoid that. Because, you know, rendering hands isn't a difficult thing to do. It wouldn't necessarily stand out as being problematic. But the other thing that makes me think that is that even though I'm not using ray tracing, you know, I don't have a graphics card that supports ray tracing, this game supports it. But something that people noticed about the ray tracing is that while they implemented, you know, lighting effects with ray tracing, they didn't do reflection effects with ray tracing, which you easily could do. And because of, you know, and here's another stupid glitch. The game thinks I want to walk through or treat that as a window when I wanted to hop onto it. And again, a little jiggy platforming. But yeah, so anyway, something people notice with the ray tracing is that, yeah, they didn't implement reflections. But the shadows seem pretty well implemented, so it doesn't seem like it was like lack of technical knowledge or, you know, it would have been too hard to do that. But it would prevent you from looking in the mirror and seeing a black man when that's not who you are. So I kind of wonder if that's, you know, of course, I wouldn't expect, you know, anybody involved in production to admit to such a thing. But I wonder if that's sort of the reasoning, right? Is that as little as possible, you know, do you see yourself, like while you are in control of the character, you don't ever have to see yourself as Colt's model. You could be anybody. But speaking of ray tracing, I have some general thoughts on that because, you know, I know a lot of people are not very impressed with the quality performance trade-off of ray tracing, but I'm definitely a firm believer that is the future. It's like eventually all games are going to be completely ray traced all the time. And this definitely does come from my background in computer graphics. It's like ray tracing was always the start. Like when people first were trying to render, you know, models of 3D objects, ray tracing was the first approach that was tried because it's the most obvious and the most realistically based. And the only reason rasterization, the technique used by modern graphics cards was adopted was because ray tracing was just too expensive. The technology did not exist. But there's really a misconception in how performant ray tracing is in the abstract. The technology absolutely exists to do highly realistic images with ray tracing in real time. Nothing is preventing that right now except for the gaming industry, right? Conceptually and in terms of the technology that's available, you could make a game that looks like this, ray traced in real time. That is 100% achievable. The problem is that because initially ray tracing wasn't performant enough with the hardware that existed when people first started trying to render things with computers, people adopted these rasterization techniques, and then graphics cards were engineered to make those techniques perform more efficiently. So the hardware was adapted to the techniques, and then the techniques became more reliant on the fact that the hardware could do that better. And so it just became like a cycle where, you know, yeah, graphics cards became more and more reliant on the assumption of rasterization, and game developers became more and more used to using rasterization as a technique. So graphics cards are completely suited for rasterization and not at all for ray tracing, right? But if you just inverted that, if you just made hardware that was optimized for ray tracing and not for rasterization, the performance difference would be way different. So it's you know, that's something that people definitely have to keep in mind. It's like, ray tracing does not have to perform as badly as it does right now. It's like the hardware is just not made to do it, right? You're trying to, you know, you're trying to use a chainsaw to paint a painting, you know, and what you need is a paintbrush. And if developers were using a paintbrush to paint the painting instead of a chainsaw, they would be getting better results. But it's not at all a fair comparison right now. But I have seen real-time ray tracing demos. You know, they're custom setups, and they're not what is standardly used in the industry. But doing real-time ray tracing is 100% possible, and it's going to make things so much easier. And it's not only going to save a lot of development time eventually, but it's going to make things look better. You know, one of the main premises of rasterization is using triangles, and you're just taking these planar triangles. You know, that's the reason for using triangles, is that the three vertices are guaranteed to form a plane. You can't have a bend. You know, it's just like a three-legged stool or something. It can't be unbalanced, or a caltrop even, you know. It has to land in a plane with a point up. So triangles have to be flat, and then you can just project them from 3D space onto the 2D space of the screen. And you know that, like, if the triangle is a particular color, then you can project the three vertices and then color everything in between the three vertices the same color. So you can break the image up into chunks, essentially. And so you don't have to do each pixel individually. You can interpolate between ranges of pixels and save a lot of time that way. So it is efficient to use triangles. But unfortunately, that creates this polygonization effect, right? Where you can see in this game, and in so many, like, you know, even in the best looking game, like, to me, this is like a complete embarrassment, where it's just like, as much as the technology has improved, and as pretty as, you know, large textures can be, the simple, you know, just a simple round object, you know, like if you look at like the vault dials and things in this game, right, they're polygons, they're hexagonal shaped, right? You almost never see just a simple sphere, right? You know, we just got a close up of that bottle, and is the bottle round? No, it's not round. It's a hex bottle, right? You just cannot do rounded shapes, because the number of triangles that you need to make the edges smooth is just astronomical, and it just impedes performance too much. But using ray tracing, that wouldn't be a problem necessarily, right? Because when you're ray tracing, instead of rasterizing, you're just intersecting the polygons. You're not projecting them anymore. You're actually getting intersection points that you can follow up throughout the 3D scene to track light sources and calculate shadows and reflections and things. So as a technique, that means that it no longer really matters what the geometry is. It costs about the same to intersect with a triangle as with it does some other kind of geometric representation. So you could just have implicit shapes, spheres, NURB surfaces, and other things, which allow you to represent geometry much more accurately for the same cost, right? So you could literally have a game with model fidelity that look like this, but the disk space would be way less than you would need for this, right? It might be a tenth of the size to get the same resolution of the geometry. And for the same disk space, you could get perfect spheres, you could get perfect cylinders, just things that looked absolutely amazing. Because yeah, even the best games have this problem of, yeah, you know, it's a wonderful picture that you're looking at, but that's what it is. It's just these are all just 2D textures pasted on really, really simple geometry. So it's the texture and the texture mapping and the anti-aliasing has gotten really good, but and geometry, animation, things like that are still, and AI, as mentioned before, pretty much everything else is lagging way behind. Ray tracing definitely. Oh my god, this is gonna break for that annoying door. say a little trick here. You don't actually need a full charge of the battery for the generators. You only need like three dots of charge. So I just fill it up to four to make sure I have the three that I need. But even with that blue door closes too quickly for you to just do it in quick charge and then get out. You have to wait for the door to close, open it back up, and then walk through. You know, just one of those. Played this so many times that very annoying. Just a little detail like that. Why can't the door just stay open a little bit longer? That would be super convenient for me, but then again, if you were trying to be stealthy and you didn't want one of the patrolling visionaries to see you, you might want the door to close a little bit faster automatically, so might just come down to play style. I'm gonna steal another fully charged battery here. There's another one upstairs as well in this room. But yeah, ray tracing is the future. It's like once, and I hope it helps with this, the whole, you know, because the big problem with graphics cards now is they're just so ridiculously overpriced thanks to cryptocurrency, right? And the thing is that the cores on traditional graphics cards can do general computation for various rasterization operations and also some simulation type stuff as well. But I think cryptocurrency mining benefits from those generalized cores, but like the ray tracing is done with these tensor cores. So they're optimized for ray tracing and certain other more scientific or technical or mathematical applications. But I don't know that they would be as good for cryptocurrency mining. So my kind of hope is that it really does become two explicit branches where it's like NVIDIA, you know, can just make graphics cards that are optimized for cryptocurrency mining, and then they can make, you know, like ray tracing graphics cards that are just completely unsuited for cryptocurrency mining but are great for making great looking video games without a lot of developer effort. And then, you know, you wouldn't see the exorbitant pricing and stock shortages that you see with graphics cards now. So yeah, so I know that for a lot of people, again, that's just me on my soapbox. I know for a lot of people look at ray tracing and be just like, oh, you know, I'm paying a lot of you know, I'm sacrificing a lot in my frame timing to get something that basically looks the same. And why would I want to do that? But yeah, long term, it's going to be so much better. It's going to be so much better for everybody to have that technology. Now, here's some great writing. The writing of Alexis. The stuck up, you know, trust fund kid. This elitist, self-absorbed, rich kid who got this huge inheritance and then thinks that he's like a god among men. It's just absolutely hilarious.
Fucking fail safe. Better not have opened these stations for nothing.
Attitude. Swagger.
Remember you!
You answer to me.
But still talking about the graphics a little bit, yeah. Not using ray shading here, ray tracing here. Using settings that I can actually run and record at, and running at, you know, about 30 frames per second. To a lot of people, I know that's annoying, and I know a lot of people probably, you know, started watching the video, and after 10 seconds are like, oh my god, you know, this isn't running 60 frames per second 4K. I can't watch this. This is giving me a headache, you know? I don't know. They probably say that MSG gives them it. MSG and 5G and radio signals and solar flares, those probably all give them headaches as well. Me, I'm really not a stickler for high frame rates and high resolution. I think those are way overblown in their performance as well. That's a to the thing I've considered doing as a separate video of just giving my hot take on this, where it's like this idea that every game has to be running at 60 frames per second at all the times. Yeah, it's got to be at least 1080p or 4K, or it's not worth playing. Yeah, I don't know. I just think that stands in direct contradiction to human physiology and perception. Another thing that I'm using, a lot of people don't like in this game, is I've got motion blur enabled here, which I think adds as realism and makes the picture look better. But I can get on all those things in a minute. I'm going to comment a little bit here on this artificial intelligence, because that's an interesting can of worms in and of itself. It's this, is 2-bit actually sentient? I mean, it's particularly interesting in his case because he's partially merged with a brain. So he's not just technology. He actually is, it's almost like a, what would you call that? Like a reverse cyborg, where he's not a human that technology has been plugged into, but he's technology that biology has been plugged into, to increase his intelligence and performance. But it's interesting to, you know, do you treat him as a user? Do you treat him as a real human being? Another interesting thing that he just referenced was seeing Charlie, his creator, as this god, which is it's definitely not surprising. A clear conflict of interest is that, you know, how can you really trust your admiration for your own creator when your creator can create you however they want, and so they can create you as a thing that inherently likes them, you know, as if you were under a spell or something. So it's a weird ethical thing. But then the other thing here is just the editing audio. It's like it's not particularly convincing, but it's good enough in the context of the game that this edited audio sounds like Alexis really inviting Wenji to this party. And so it's like an audio deepfake, and it's definitely quite an interesting topic that's still under development of, yeah, just putting words into people's mouths and then making it increasingly impossible. You know, it's already hard enough to track down information, but then you have these really psychologically convincing approximations of real people. You know, it's only going to get better. Another weird game glitch. I was trying to teleport there, but the hand gesture kind of makes it look like that the character's trying to do the ether ability from Igor to turn invisible. So I don't know exactly what caused that, but that's, I'm going to say that's a glitch. But anyway, yeah, deep fix, a world of problems. But anyway, going back to, circling back to, resolution, frame rate, blurring, you know, it's completely about what's being shown, right? Like, here's a great example. This image sequence is lower resolution than the rest of the game, right? It's got a lower, what you might call, spatial resolution or spatial detail, right? Right. It's like, it's about the amount of detail that's in the image that you're seeing, and then how often the image changes, right? So, like, to show a, like, if what I was trying to show you was a black screen that was just static, then all I need is one pixel resolution. That pixel has to be black. And then my refresh rate, you know, can be once every never, right? I mean, it could be one frame per second. It would be fine, right? It would 100% capture the underlying content that I was trying to show you, right? So if you don't have a lot of detail, then you don't need a lot of pixels. And if the image isn't changing very quickly, then you don't need a lot of frame rate. And that's why, like, you know, Nintendo games can look good on inferior hardware, because they do a cartoon style where there's subtle shading, you know, and there's lots of flat white areas of color. There's not a lot of variation in detail. And then larger circles, basically, for like cotton candy clouds and trees and things like that. You know, they're cutesy or Funko Pop proportioned characters. The larger spheres involved have larger external arcs, and so you get less aliasing, and so you need less resolution to avoid jagged edges. And then again, if things move more slowly, if it's not a fast-paced FPS shooter, then you need lower frame rates too. So it really is specific to the game and what you need. And from like a competitive standpoint, you need enough resolution to be able to see relevant details of the game, like, you know, when you approach close enough to like another character, like another player in a competitive game, for them to like pop up in drawing visibility, right? It's like the draw distances is long enough and you're close enough that they would draw on your screen. It's like, can, you know, do they show up as enough pixels that you can see them? And is your, you know, at the fastest speed that they're moving, like if another player's like in a vehicle or something, the fastest speed that they move at the furthest distance they can be away from you, can your graphics card update the frame quick enough that you can follow their path of motion? Because if you can interpolate between the frames to find their path of motion, then you can snipe them from 50 feet away. Having more frames smooths the motion, but it doesn't give you more directional information about which direction they're going. And then higher resolutions can give you more detail if you're looking at the image as a still. But when you're in motion, moving really quickly through a game, it's like it doesn't matter. And so they're almost like inverses. It's like the lower the frame rate, the more resolution you want, and the less resolution the faster you're moving, the higher your frame rate and the lower the resolution you need. So just having both of these things as high as possible all the time is really not necessary. And, you know, I think, you know, when I'm playing a game like this, you know, again, this game, I wish performed a little bit better, because it does drop frames and things. And I'm not saying it's a great thing, but
the part where everyone here is an asshole.
So you want to walk out? Your answer to everything.
Yeah, for the most part, I think it's good enough for gameplay. You can see everything you need to see. The information is updated as fast as it needs to be, and the subjective perception is the only thing that really matters. Because, yeah, under test conditions, yeah, you know, yes, people can detect changes in resolution and frame rate to the very fine details, right? It's like, yeah, a lot of people have no problem telling the difference between 60 frames and 120 frames, and even 120 and 240. Some people can tell the difference between that. And you can tell the differences in resolution, but, you know, in terms of the experience that you have when playing the game, I don't know that it makes that much difference. Again, I sincerely doubt it makes any kind of competitive difference. Except in terms of what you're used to, in terms of timing. So as long as it's consistent, it doesn't really matter. Yeah, actually, from this sort of leads into motion blur as well, because I'm using motion blur here. And again, sort of one theory of why it's so despised in video games is because the earliest implementations were just like a total frame ghosting, right? So we just persist the previous frame a little bit at a reduced opacity, sort of like trails or you know, like an onion skinning kind of effect. And it, yeah, it would blur the image, but it didn't look really good and it wasn't very accurate. But if you do like per object motion blurring, that looks pretty good subjectively, and it's definitely more realistic. In real life, motion blur is basically a post-processing effect applied by your brain to objects that move more than twice their own width per second, right? So objects that are moving relatively fast for their size get blurred by your brain on purpose. And the reason for that is a survival adaptation, is to show you that an object is moving quickly. And the blurring effect helps you interpret the object's direction of motion. So it helps you see direction or to perceive the trajectory and also perceive that something is moving fast, right? So it's a survival adaptation that lets you see, for example, if something is moving very quickly at your head, you know, you're alighting the details of exactly what the object is or what color it is or, you know, what pattern is on the fur of the monster that's coming at you. It's just like, this thing is moving quickly and it's moving at me, or it's moving, you know, at my kids over there, and I've got to do something to stop it, right? So from like a competitive perspective, right, it's like, you know, I'm playing like a competitive game, and you want to like track the trajectory of like a moving player or a moving vehicle or something, you actually want motion blur on those things, because it makes the trajectory easier to see, and it visually highlights the object as distinct from everything else because it's more blurred. And again, the details of like, you know, what color is the vehicle that's traveling, you know, what gear is this other player right now? It's like, it's more important to see that they're there and that they're moving in a particular direction at a particular rate. Again, that's exactly why motion blur exists in the human mind. Now the other complication factor here is that, you know, the game's blur effect is labeled as camera blur. It actually seems to work more like human blur, but camera blur is not quite the same because everything gets blurred basically an equal amount. If the camera is moving, like if the camera moves through a static scene, then everything gets blurred, and that can be distracting. But what this game seems to be doing is that, yeah, objects moving at a certain relative speed are blurred, and the blurring is accomplished pretty efficiently by persisting just part of the frame that is moving. So it looks like it's happening in screen space, and just if there's enough delta in pixels of an object, then the object's that part of the frame that the object is in is persisted, but it's not completely persisted. It's basically a dissolve effect is applied to it to give it a pseudo transparency. So it's not actually made transparent, and it's not actually blurred. It's just sort of like a stippled version of it is persisted, but that does create sort of a motion blur effect. But it ends up looking a little bit grainy, which is a little unrealistic, but it doesn't look bad in my opinion, and it's probably a pretty efficient implementation. And again, it's more realistic. It's more realistic, but it's also more cinematic because, of course, when objects move quickly in front of a camera, you get blurring as well, but for a different reason, and that's just because of the shutter persistence. So it's like as the camera shutters open and film or a sensor is being exposed and an object's moving, it's you know, creating turbulence in the gathered image data, and so the sensor of the film sees the same object at different points in the same frame, and so the frame ends up blurred. And this gets with, like, you know, this relates to frames and frame rates and image blurring, you know, and the debates over, you know, 24 frames per second and high frame rate, 48 frames per second, etc. It happens to be that when you film at 24 frames per second, when objects move at typical speeds, the amount of sensor blurring that you get or film emulsion blurring that you get is similar. It's a similar amount of blur for objects moving at similar speeds as to what you would see in real life. So it's actually a little bit exaggerated, which provides a little bit of a dreamlike effect. But it's comparable. So it's just kind of a happy coincidence that filming frames at 24 frames per second gives you a realistic amount of blur, at least when the camera is stationary. Now, if you whip the camera around, then things get just universally blurry and it doesn't quite look right. But so you don't see a lot of high speed camera movement. You usually get more slower pans and it's the objects that are moving quickly, not the camera. It's also just physically hard to move cameras particularly quickly in a manner that's safe. So that's a contributing factor, but. It's probably a better location for that turret that I was using, but effective. Finding Fia's pictograms. And I end up visiting all the locations here, even though I don't have to. You just need four of them, and it's random which four that you need per run, so it takes a variable amount of time to find them all, but yeah. Just for the sake of completeness, I'm visiting them all here. Got it. But anyway, my little soapbox stance. I think high frame rates and high resolution are marketing ploys, and I think people get used to seeing things at 60 frames per second and at certain resolutions. And I think psychologically, people get upset when they detect that the frame rate is not 60 frames or it's not 1080p or 4K. It's like you can visually tell the difference and you can convince yourself that it matters, but I don't think it does matter, like honestly. Perceptually, I very much doubt, like with a game in motion, that you'd be able to tell resolution certainly changing, and then from a practical and competitive standpoint, I don't think frame rate matters very much most of the time. And motion blurring, I think, is universally good. It looks better. It looks more realistic. Motion blur actually helps compensate for lower frame rates. It helps smooth out motion and trajectories. So it provides a smoother, though less detailed experience. And it also looks more cinematic. So it's more accurate to human vision, it's more accurate to camera vision, it's practically better, it's competitively advantageous, and it's a pretty inexpensive effect to apply. So again, that's another thing. It's just people have these weird ideas about what graphics should look like, but I think people are just misinformed, but whatever. If you want to spend more than you need on a graphics card, I guess more power to you. No. Yeah, Colt's just finding out that Juliana is his girl Lila's daughter, which means almost certainly his daughter. It's actually elaborated on a little bit in a voiceover, though I don't think I actually get to it in this run. But, you know, in what sense is she actually his daughter? You know, it's this weird identity problem of he doesn't remember, Colt doesn't remember anything about this life. And, is he really the same person? And thus, you know, since he has no memory of a relationship with Juliana, to what extent does he now, you know? It's like, how is she any different than some random person off the street, you know, except in interpreting her actions, where it's like, it's kind of bizarre. You know, he finds out, you know, okay, Juliana's my daughter, and yet she has such a contentious relationship, you know? Important role. Family. disappointed with her actual life. I think she can escape it somehow here. But she strikes me as very selfish, you know. All these people living here just always think it's the first day, you know. If they had known that this is how it was going to be, they probably wouldn't have chosen to be in this situation. And, you know, she's... Juliana is sort of a god in this world. But, oh, and by the way, I just passed the grate where you can, if you want to be a little stealthier, there's a note on a sort of desk-like object with a code to, a closet in Hangar 1. That takes you through a tunnel into this room that doesn't have a bunch of poisonous gas into it. So, yeah, the easy way to get the code for that safe in the other room so that you can have an alternate path into this hangar is to go that back way up the outside of this this hangar and then grab it through the exposed rebar, you know. Harriet is probably the easiest Eternalist to kill. And this is very interesting. So here with the white masks and her interest in this poison gas, she reminds me of the Dr. Poison character from Wonder Woman, like the first Wonder Woman film, because, you know, she was a doctor who specialized in, it's like a scientist specializing in poison who wears like a partial face mask, and so I wondered if that was part of the inspiration for that character's design. Obviously, she's got some religious zealotry going on too, but I mean, there's many points of reference for that. It's a very tropish character. I'm making my way through these peons towards the exit. This is definitely the home stretch. This is the day of breaking the loop, one visionary at a time. Definitely picked up Harriet's Nexus ability. It's the only other, like, I really don't care for the, you know, like teleport is awesome, but the other slab abilities, don't really need them. Don't really do anything for me. I mean, the invisibility is too weak to be useful when it's not upgraded. It helps you get past, you know, it always fools security bots, but you know, you can get by them very easily with hacking and with teleport. And then you're so overpowered in this game. This game's not particularly hard, so don't need any offensive or defensive things that either offered by the other slabs. So. Doesn't even know how old he is, poor Colton. But yeah, that's the other thing with Juliana, is it's just like the days run together. She doesn't know how old she is. She's read so many books. She probably knows a lot of things, but it only applies in the loop, right? As long as she's stuck in the loop, it's like, you know, she can't impress anybody with that knowledge. She can't publish a research paper anywhere. She can't help humanity in any way with anything she's learned, you know. She's powerful in this realm by herself, right? And she's a lot, and like, I mean, like, what good is it? it's nothing's changing, and so nothing's serving either purpose. But yeah, this goes interesting. I just totally screwed this up right here. It's funny. I guess like the only time I did, you can just pull the batteries out of those turrets if you activate them, but you're supposed to teleport inside to completely avoid the laser security there, and then they just don't turn on at all, and then you can just throw the switch on the bottom floor. Like that, that's how I was supposed to enter. And you can just come down here and throw the switch, and then you don't have to get shut at all. getting very lazy here, but oh well. But yeah, I'm just not exactly sure what Juliana wants. Maybe she doesn't know either, you know? Again, just speaking to the character psychology. You know, looking at, like, the lore of the game seems to be essentially, you know, this was a naturally occurring temporal anomaly on this island of Black Reef, and it was discovered and studied by some kind of military outfit, codename Operation Horizon. And part of the staff for that outfit was Colt and Lila, and they ended up in a relationship together. They had a little thing going that resulted in Juliana. But then Colt participated in sort of a botched experiment where he was, you know, put in some kind of plane or possibly the same rocket car that we see. And sort of sent through the loop energy, possibly that big antenna thing that Juliana's in, which incidentally kind of resembles a large Ferris wheel and is sort of in keeping with the theme of everyone treating the island or the Eternalist treating the island like it's this big amusement park. That's kind of a coincidence in terms of the lore, but yeah, so Colt was like thrown through the anomaly, but the scientist overseeing the experiment, you know, kind of didn't really follow protocol, and he basically got thrown through time and had his brain scrambled and then showed up many years later. Confused and was like committed to an asylum, and then eventually he somehow got into a relationship with Igor Sterling, the scientist, and since Colt had been to this island before, he basically helped Igor find it again after Operation Horizon had ended, and he came back, and as the other Colt said here, in a similar bunker to this one, not this bunker, but that other power station where he gets the ARC password, his own ARC password from the game he was playing with his lover Lila. When that happens, the other Colt talks about, you know, he thought he could go back and use, you know, the place like it was using him or whatever. And so I think that's to imply that basically, you know, when Colt remembered what happened, he thought maybe he could do something with the temporal anomaly to go back in time and live with Lila again and have that be his sort of endless time loop, you know? And he was hoping to do that, and then, you know, basically came to realize that it wasn't possible. But possibly while that was going on, while he was doing that, Lila was actually still alive, although she had gotten sick. So it's almost like a Peter Quill type situation, you know, Star-Lord type situation, where she had got sick possibly as a result of being subjected to the weird stuff going on in this island. But she was living with her daughter Juliana, and she was sick. And instead of Colt coming to find her and living with her and his daughter in the, you know, Lila's final days, he was out here coming back to the island, you know, trying to figure out a way to go back in time to a prior version of Lila and himself and their life together in a different thing. So he was sort of ignoring the real opportunity, you know, flawed as it was, in reality, trying to get back to this perfect fantasy. And then his daughter Juliana resented that. And here I'm just waiting for the people to drown. actually sped this up a little bit. It takes a while for them to just got to sit here and stare at the stare at the door while they drown. But yeah, it seems like Juliana was really upset that you know she feels like you know he abandoned them in reality and was kind of mad at him for that reason. And you can see you know that she's put in this situation where she's part of this loop with her father Colt, but he starts the loop, you know, like blackout drunk without any memory. You know, his memory was probably rattled a little bit from that botched experiment anyway, but it's like they kind of had a relationship maybe before the loop started, but then after the loop started, he doesn't know who he is and develops this obsession with breaking the loop. He basically becomes a different person who wants to destroy this program that they were both a part of. And so, you know, it's like Juliana still wants a relationship with Colt, you know, her father, but he's not the same person anymore. And she was mad at him for not being there when Lila died, but he doesn't remember that. And so she can't hold him accountable. And, you know, so it's like this weird love-hate relationship where, you know, she was up for ending the loop, something could change. You know, it's like Colt could remember and they could have a new relationship. They could have a new life. They could try to patch things up, but it's like, she doesn't want that. It's like she prefers, like Juliana prefers this world where, you know, Colt only sometimes remembers what's going on. He only sometimes has a personality, but when he does, he's sort of this other person. So it's like, it's a way to have this just endless tortured relationship. So it's both, it's like Juliana is both sadistic and masochistic, you know? She wants to hurt Colt and punish him for things that he doesn't remember. And here I'm like, yeah. Nexus is by far the easiest way to handle this particular situation. You take out two Eternalists at once, and you don't even have to kill one of them directly. You just, or two of the Visionaries. You kill one Eternalist to kill two Visionaries with one Eternalist stone. Yeah, but like, yeah, Juliana just clinging to this totally imperfect, unhealthy relationship. It's like she wants to have a positive relationship with Colt, I think, but more than that, it's more important that he can never leave, I think, to her. That's sort of my, what I'm interpreting in the, if I'm psychoanalyzing the character, right, is that she would rather, you know, him be a murdering psychopath who doesn't know who she is. But he can't, you know, it's like, yeah, that's the case, but he can never leave. He can never leave. He can never leave her. Right. And she doesn't have to be, alone, like ever. Like he can't abandon her, but he's, you know, it's just a constant thorn in her side. And as she says in the ending cinematic, it's like she's kind of learned to enjoy it, or convinced herself that she likes it, that she likes this incredibly fraught antagonistic relationship, where they're just, you know, her and Cole are just trying to kill each other all the time. Very strange. Very bizarre, very interesting. But like, thinking about the world of the game in general is pretty bizarre. Like, the thing that I don't get is, it's like Juliana and sometimes Colt can remember things from day to day, but nobody else can. And that, to me, is kind of what I would expect, because memory formation you know, requires changes, physical changes in the brain, right? Like you need new neural connections and in chemical traces and things to happen in the brain in order for memories to be stored, and their, you know, memories are like finalized through sleeping overnight. But you know, in this world, the loop keeps happening, so everything resets from day to day. And that was the promise of the loop, is that yeah, you could put a bullet in your head and jump off a cliff and drink as much as you want and do as many drugs as you want, and it wouldn't matter. This is an interesting sequence. This I feel like is a reference to Escape from New York, because it's totally blackout, and then you see his progress towards the eye antenna on that little screen there, and that's very similar to the opening. It's like a low budget opening to Escape from New York, where Snake Plissken gets sent into the ship to New York City, which is, you know, been turned into this derelict prison state in that film. But they didn't have the budget to like shoot a model plane like going into the city and crashing, and so what they do instead is they just show the action happening on a little vector graphic screen, just like the one here. And so it's a way to save costs. It's because you don't actually have to model the environment that he's going through. But yeah, it's so similar to that. If it's not a direct reference, that they at least stole the idea from it to save on development effort. But that's kind of interesting.
Don't worry.
And then we're getting here. So very, very strange. Juliana's gonna try to convince him not to break the loop after she's done nothing but try to convince him to do it for the whole duration of the game.
Welcome back.
This ain't normal.
In that case, are dueling pistols. Vintage pieces. Original.
And of course, yeah, it's like I immediately recognize these from Dishonored. Those pistols are from the game Dishonored.
Preserving. Like Black Reef.
Yeah, preserving what though? It's like that's the thing that's funny to me, because nothing changes. Nothing changes, so there's no history to record. The only history there is her own history. And she keeps on insisting on doing the same thing. And she actually doesn't do all the things that she could do. She insists on repeating this drama with Colt. And there's certain mysteries that she never uncovers, like the fact that there's, you know, one of the many little hidden nuggets is this side story with this character, Pick Rexley, who is another person on Black Reef who can remember. So Juliana thinks that it's just Colt and her that remember things, but actually there's at least one other person that does as well, officially. But again, she never noticed, because she never really tried to find out.
About the other Colt?
Yeah, that's never actually explained, by the way. It's like this fact that cults can just appear in and give advice and things. I really like how they all have different personalities, and even though it's the same voice actor, the voice acting, the directing, and the writing of the characters is all very different, so they all feel like different people, which is pretty cool. Yeah, and then she became obsessed with it, and she'd never... She's caught in a time loop. You know, it's like a psychological pattern of behavior, just like, it's like always picking bad relationship partners and always having crappy relationships, or, you know, always going back to abusing the same drugs and things. It's just this psychological pattern. It's like she has infinite time to keep changing and improving, but she really doesn't. Now I'm gonna shoot her in the head now. I don't even hesitate. She proposes that you count to three and then shoot, and then you can choose to shoot her or you can choose to not shoot her. I shoot her right away, and I shot her right away on the first playthrough as well. And in looking at like videos of endings on this, it seems like that's actually not the ending that a lot of people like. Like, people like the ending where you don't shoot her and, like, you live in the time loop, which, I don't know, to me, like, morally is so perverse. It just completely ignores everyone else on the island who is just stuck living the same day over and over again and not making any progress. It's like, again, it's what is the point of learning anything on this island unless you're sharing it with other people who can appreciate it? It's like, if you know, they can live 10,000 years in the time loop and become masters of all knowledge and whatnot, but, you know, as far as anyone else is concerned, the island might as well never exist because nobody benefits from it from them. So it's like they get to become completely self-actualized in a sense, but in another sense, nothing changes. So it's a very bizarre thing. I mean, I see the appeal. You know, there is some innate appeal to this idea of living in a time loop, presuming that you could remember from day to day, where it's like, you know, so many you know, bad things from life could be eliminated, right? It's like before that first day when things loop, you could set things up, you know, really well. You could, you know, you could get yourself in good shape. You could live really clean. You could clean up your place. You know, you make your bed, you get a good night's sleep. And so then when you wake up every day, everything is totally pristine, right? And then you can do whatever you want, right? If you just set things up really nicely, then you could just, you know, get shit-faced every day. You could kill people every day. You could take endless risks and things. And then the next morning, it wouldn't matter. You'd be well-rested and everything would be clean and put back the way it was. And so it would get by a lot of tedium. But, you know, yeah, that the fact that nothing ever changes, yeah, I don't know. And of course, it's not the case that, and it makes sense, that not everybody would be able to get themselves in that position, you know, and you see lots of evidence of that throughout the course of the game where, you know, Eternalists are complaining that they threw out their back for the beginning of the time loop, and, you know, the weather's not totally perfect, and, you know, they ran out of, like, a particular, you know, food dish at some of the food stands. They weren't properly stocked before the first day, and so there's certain problems like that that just happen by accident, through random accidents of scheduling, and those things can never be fixed, right? It's like the little mistakes and the little problems that weren't addressed before the first day are now permanent. So yeah, certain things can never get worse, but then other things can never get better. And it's kind of a sad trade-off, but yeah, it's really strange to me that it's not particularly plausible that any scientist would think that you would be able to preserve your memory from day to day. It's like if everything else resets physically about you, then psychologically you wouldn't be able to form new memories. It's really a mystery as to why, Colt and Juliana can do that. They can remember things somehow. And I could say more about that. I could say more about a lot of things related to this game. Unfortunately, though, we're getting to the end of this this playthrough. I am out of time. Maybe I should have played more slowly and I could have said more things. I don't know, that remains to be seen if people actually have interest in this kind of video, because I can certainly do it again, maybe for a popular game in the future. Maybe a game that people actually care about. But I like this game. Like I said, it's very interesting conceptually, and I wish the execution had been a little bit better in some respects, but I certainly had fun playing it, and I think the replay value is really good on this game because of the premise and because of all the little side missions and things there are. So I had a good time. I hope you had a good time listening to my commentary.